I'm going to begin by showing these tools in general. So if you have something that you're working on already, or just want to draw something on your own, that's perfectly fine too. Basically just going over how these tools function. So so yes, first of all, let me just enlarge this here. I mentioned in the previous class that there are several ways in which you can create a surface, and so just to go over that, basically if I if I draw a freeform curve, that's a closed curve, then very easily I can create a surface from that by just going into surface from planar curves. And so if we look at that in perspective view, you can see that this is a surface that was created from this curve. Let me just change this color a bit darker. And then also there is a pretty handy tool which I usually use when I have something, a gap to fill that's planar, and that's called the surface from 3 or 4 corner points. So I mean, showing here, it's kind of free form, but basically you can either do 3 or again 4 points that you just click wherever you want and create a simple linear surface. And so I mean, these surfaces are pretty simple, and when it gets more challenging is with surfaces that have curvature, and that can be curvature in one direction, and often it can be curvature in two directions. And so, yeah, let's say I create something, I do a very simple lofting operation. So I'm going to just draw 2 circles, and and love them together. So, I mean, even such a surface is relatively easy to understand. When it gets more complicated is when you have 3-dimensional curves that you use to define a surface. And so, so today I want to look at these 3 tools that I briefly described before, or previous class. That can be used to create a surface from a network of curves. And so they are network surface, sweep 2, so sweep across 2 rails, and patch. And so if you look in this file, up here I have a few examples. Basically, I'm going to just hide this surface layer and make a new one for redoing this. So I basically have a few examples of a series of curves that I have drawn to show an example of this parasitic intervention. And so I'll show how each of these tools can be used to create a surface from these curves, and the result in each cases will be slightly different. So so the idea of with the tool network surface is that you have a series of curves running in two directions. They don't need to be perpendicular, but basically two sets of curves, and you can use them to define a surface. And so the important thing, and for this I'm just going to actually jump to the Rhino like tool online help, because it really clearly describes the principles, while my example is a bit looks maybe more complex. So usually what I do for tools, I look this up, and their own website is the first that comes up. And so you can see in this example that what I'm saying about two series of curves is like this. So basically, you see this note here that all curves in one direction must cross all curves in the other direction and cannot cross each other. So you can see that these three blue curves, they are parallel to each other, they don't cross each other, and they perfectly they line up, their endpoints line up with here the two endpoints of the red curves, and then these two middle ones too, the middle blue curve and the middle red curve, touches each other. And so that's the example that I have here created in Rhino. So and in fact, maybe it makes it easier if I just move these to a different layer, so they are actually a different color. So in my example, these are basically the two series of curves. And so actually, for creating network surface, what I would do is leave, oh yeah, and here it's actually, this one is right now joined together, so I'm going to explode that, because I don't need this piece here. So what I'm going to do is just type network surface and see what it's asking me to do. So actually, for this command, you can select all the curves and then run the command, and sometimes it will ask you to select them in a more organized order. So I'm selecting these three curves and then these five curves and press enter. And so this window comes up and I can actually preview what's happening, and it looks pretty nice. And so with most of these more advanced commands, there are some options adjusting various properties. I basically would say that for all intents and purposes, usually the default version works. And so only go into the kind of adjusting the details if something is not happening. So basically this is the result. And so one thing that's important to understand is that, and let me just redo this command to just emphasize one thing. So you can see that there are tolerances defined, and for the edge curves and the interior curves, and that relates to the kind of precision, yes? Network surface. It's listed on the, it's actually just the text behind my model here. So basically, the thing with all of these commands is, don't imagine that you pick these curves and Rhino is going to perfectly touch all of them with the surface that's defined. And so later today, I'm going to show you how we will encounter problems when you would think after what you did that there are two surfaces next to each other that are perfectly touching, but actually not, because basically the way the particular curves are and the way the kind of automatic function of defining the simplest geometry works is that it actually kind of averages the geometry. So basically the results in each of the cases will be different. I mean, network surface is nice because you can actually, I'm choosing in the kind of vertical sweeping direction, I'm choosing 5 curves. And so really it looks like if I move around that this shape is quite aligned with the curves that I wanted. And of course the base question is, what am I doing with this form? But right now it's just an example. This example is not really tailored to any particular performance at the moment, apart from, you know, a non-orthogonal room being that. And the kind of base rectangle in the back here is actually one bay of the Lasserre building, so that's what I'm basing this on. And so let's look at what we can do with this geometry if we want to use the sweep command. So basically the idea of sweep 2 is that similarly to sweep 1 that we did from now I can do sweep 2 of these vertical lines to help me average, in this case, the top and bottom planes. And so in this case, I would actually join these together so that, well, actually it depends. I don't even need to do that. It depends if you want a closed, solid to have a surface in the back of your object, but then you have to do it. But it actually will work without. So I'm going to type sweep 2. And so it asks me to select my first rail. And so I basically can, this time I can choose between which curves I want. And so right now I'm selecting these two. And then basically you have to select the cross-section curves. And so you can see already that because in this case I'm sweeping between the bottom and the top freeform curves, it's not considering the one in the middle. So in fact, you can see that network surface is a kind of higher degree or more sophisticated command, but depending on what you want to do, sweep might be sufficient. If you actually don't want to, you want to just fully average two curves without defining it more. Or what you actually could do is use the sweep command from top to the middle and then from the middle to the bottom and then kind of refine the two surfaces that are created. And so again, there are some options about the complexity of the surface that's going to be created, how many control points and so on you want to create. And so that's what you get. And then thirdly, the patch command basically works by defining a series of curves, and that would be the edges of a future surface, and then it creates a surface that is kind of the best fit between them. So an example would be, I think I have the lines broken here, would be selecting these 4 curves and then typing patch, and so basically that's what is created here. And so one thing I want to emphasize that it looks that at the moment with this example, the edges line up quite well with this curve, but I warn you not to make the assumption that the surface that's created is equal to the curves that served as the base. And so again, later we will encounter this problem. And I was trying things out and couldn't join surfaces together, because when you infinitely zoom in, you realize, and I don't know if that might be already the case here. Sometimes it's just the way things are displayed, but yeah, so here it looks like, and it's a bit hard to see, but it looks like that this corner might not actually be lining up with that point where the two curves intersect. And so that's going to be a problem later on when if you, let's say, create a surface from the top plane and you want to join them together. And so, yeah, in a little bit I'll show what you can do if that happens. And so, yeah, basically these are the three commands that, depending on what you are drawing, and I do encourage you to begin by sketching something and then drawing curves in 2D and then potentially 3D and then start making surfaces from that. You will be using some of these or all of these. And actually there is something that I haven't mentioned before, which is also important to know, is the difference between an untrimmed surface and a trimmed surface. So so I have two examples here, and so basically let's just move this down. So an untrimmed surface is basically a surface that's kind of a primal surface. It's created by one of the basic surface tools, and so in this case it's just a surface made from a rectangle, and in this case this chunk here is actually one of the surfaces that I copied over from these examples that I'm showing. And so it's a surface that's created from a series of curves that are three-dimensional. And so basically when I turn on, for each of these surfaces, when I turn on points, which is the command that we have used before for curves, it's called points on, you can see that the two surfaces are displayed in quite a different way. So this simple untrimmed surface actually has four points that are located at the corner of the surface. And so I can drag these points and it remains this simple geometry. On the other hand, this untrimmed surface, it looks like, let's look at it from top view. So it's actually defined by a kind of this kind of distorted grid of control points. And so basically the idea behind it for Rhino is that there is a kind of simpler, more complete geometry from that is basically a full grid that has been distorted. And this is, I mean, I just use one command, I think the patch command, to create this surface, but in terms of how it's mathematically described, that is the case. And so why that is important, because if you want to manipulate this surface, you actually, and so I mentioned before, or we saw an example of this last class, of the example of the flame of the candle, where the surface is kind of morphed. And so what I can do is I can start dragging these points, and so you can see, and this might be easier to see in a rendered view, that I'm sort of creating these bumps on the surface. And so, I mean, this particular operation you would be using if you created a geometry, and yes, maybe there is a kind of finer scale detailing that you want to do. At the same time, what I'm doing right now is quite unprecise, just in perspective view dragging, and I could be moving these points at a measured dimension, but basically this is not a very precise way to be working with geometry. So I just want you to be aware of the possibility of manipulating a surface like this, but I would think more critically about, like, let's say there are these bumps, then how do you define it? How do you maybe create a small surface that you will join and trim with this bigger one to create some sort of articulation on the surface? Or maybe you begin by actually drawing an overall smooth geometry that has little articulations on it. And related to this idea that this is an untrimmed surface with this kind of complex grid is the idea of rebuilding a surface. So let me just go back to ghost view. So what I have here is again this same surface, and so the both of these are identical to the previous undistorted iteration of the surface. And so in the two cases, I have used the rebuild command to basically make them more simple or more refined. So let's say I do want to manipulate the surface by moving points on it. And so in this case, I rebuilt it with more control points than it used to have. And in this case, I simplified it. And so, of course, if you decrease the number of points, at some point the curvature is going to change and so on. So what you do is you just type rebuild, and so it tells you the point count that in each directions of this surface, and they are defined by two axes, even though it's a three-dimensional surface, so U and V axes. Right now it has 5 points in each, and so you know, I could say that what happens if it has 2 points, and so the surface that is now created isn't and actually let's see, did it even, yeah, so it actually wasn't able to do 2 points, it went down to 4 points, and that seems to be the lowest amount of points to be able to define this geometry, yes? It's basically another version for X, Y, Z, it's U, V, and W, I guess? Yeah, so it's the two directions. So I could, when I do rebuild, then the two numbers don't need to be the same. I can say that in the U direction I want 10, and in the V direction I want 5, and so I guess you can see that the, yeah, which one was which? So the U direction is X, and the V direction is Y, and so that's just how surfaces work. Again, it's basically this three-dimensional grid that, because a surface we understand as this, it's basically it's something that doesn't have a thickness, but of course it has a variability in each direction. Yeah. Yeah, and I have to say that I mean, this, you know, this course is still being iterated, and so I think when it gets to really understanding these surfaces, I wonder if that's really another level of Rhino. So I mean, I think that one is perfectly able to use Rhino for most of the things that we do without really intimately understanding how geometry is defined in the software. So you know, don't worry about it too much. But at the same time, for sure, during your work, you will encounter issues. And so then one needs to be mindful that there is always a kind of degree of precision with which geometry is defined. And so you cannot do everything with any kind of geometry, because it's just going to fail. Okay, and so a few other things that I want to show before kind of going through a series of steps with an example is, once you have a number of surfaces, then how can you kind of work with them in relation to each other? And so the few examples here have show that. So first of all, here I have these two blue surfaces, which are actually, I think I just copied the same surface over and maybe rotated it a bit. And so Rhino has the capability to create an average between them, and the distance between these can be anything. It can be a really small distance, and it can be a really large distance. So let's see if I can just... I'm going to hide this guy for a second. So I can use these two curves to loft, and so you can see that they are quite radically different, because the loft sort of drew this more straight path. I mean, it's still three-dimensionally, it's a double curved surface, but the one that's created, and so what's actually the command here is blend surface, so I can type that, and so it's asking me not just to select the surface, but actually select the edges that I want to blend together. And so again, some things to adjust here. And so there is a smooth blend created. And once you do that, then you can take these three surfaces and join them together. Let's just enlarge this so I can see. Doesn't say, but basically these are now seamlessly joined into an open poly surface. So this is what I will be using when I have two surfaces that seemingly align, but actually I need, there's a gap between them, and so you can blend that gap. And obviously if, just explode this. Obviously, if I bring these closer together and try to blend them, the closer you have geometries that aren't quite aligned, the more the less smooth transition you will get. So depending on what is your process of defining a geometry, and I would say that for this assignment it really be should be thought of as something experimental, so you aren't too worried about how rigorous your process is in terms of what is this going to be made of. And like, we can create a giant blob surface, but in reality it's going to be made of pieces, at least pieces that will be joined together somehow, whether that's rolled steel welded together like Richard Serra's installations, or some fiberglass material. It won't arrive in a huge scale to the construction site for the most part, but Rhino is a really good tool to experiment with different geometries, and then once there is an overall idea, then that gets refined on a finer scale. And so I wouldn't approach the assignment with that kind of rigor, because I mean that takes time and a number of iterations. But so I would say that in this case, if I have these two surfaces and I want to blend them together in a smoother way, then what I would do is actually cut them back further to give more space for the geometry to be able to blend in a smoother way. And so what you can do, and I think I already showed this tool, is to and I'll just switch to top view. You can draw a cut plane through these objects, which is basically a surface perpendicular to the C plane that I'm drawing in. And so let's say I do that, and then so if you look at this in perspective view, basically these planes that are created just surround, fully incorporate the objects that I had selected, and then I can trim these objects. Yeah, so I can trim this surface with this, and so get rid of that part, and I can do the same thing with this one, and then I don't need these anymore. And once I have that, again, do blend surface. Oops, and so now it seems like the direction is reversed, and so one thing that's helpful in this case is to click on the same point on both surfaces, and so let's see, yeah, so in that case, because I was clicking kind of across, and then it actually wants to do the opposite. So pay attention to that too, that where you click is actually an input for Rhino to understand better what you want to do. And so you can see that now this would be a much smoother transition. Of course, my geometry is different, but the question is whether that dimension is important or the smooth curvature is important. So yeah, that's a blend surface. And then there's another handy command which you can also use to kind of average, flip this side down. Oh yeah, to average geometries together. So in this example, and the command is called match surface. So basically, and this command is specific to untrimmed surfaces, I would say, unfortunately. So you can see that I have a simpler surface here that again is defined by a series of points. You can see that it's untrimmed because the corners constitute points as opposed to this other surface, which is you can see that this this point grid extends beyond the surface itself. So what I can do, and what the magenta example is showing, is to redefine this surface, basically this edge that's closest to this other more complex surface, using the geometry of that surface. And so how it works in actual life is you type match surface, and so now it's asking you to select an untrimmed surface edge to change. And just to show, if I try to select this one, it's telling me edge must be on the edge of a surface, not a trimmed edge. And so this is a trimmed edge. So if you don't know what you're working with, then you can find out through this. So I can select this edge, and then it's asking me to select the segment that I want to match, and so that's this one. And so you can see that it brings up this preview of how it would keep the original, the other edge of this surface, and then redefine it by bringing it to this edge. And so yes, so that's the result. And so that can be, again, good if you have somehow two parts of your model that you have defined, and then you want to somehow bring them closer together. And then again, if I arrive to this, then I can, so what this example is showing is to basically take this gap and create a new surface from that. And if everything worked perfectly, then I hopefully should be able to join the surfaces together, but actually that's not the case. So this is where problems arise, that when we are creating more complex surfaces than just to be able to define a particular curvature. Something is slightly off with these three, Rhino wasn't able to join them together. So some more operations would have to be done to achieve that. And so what I want to do is show that through that other example in the model, what can be done. So let's jump back to that. Oh yeah, but actually before there is one more example here for filleting a surface. So you can see in this magenta example that I took each of these two edges and did a fillet. And so for that the command is just fillet surface. So in this case it's asking to select two surfaces to fillet. It note that it's different from filleting an edge, and actually I didn't check what my radius was, so I'm just gonna undo that. So yeah, my radius was 1, which is not gonna really show, so I'm gonna change that to, let's say, 100. And yeah, so you can see that basically it's creating this new piece of surface that's between them. And what is already happening is, because of this fillet operation, it actually cut off the corner of this surface. So you will encounter these that basically logically or geometrically it's impossible to undertake this operation without getting rid of that piece. And so then if you want this to once again be a complete form, you actually have to take these curves and probably use the patch command to fill that hole, and then you will encounter the issue that the curvature of that new piece will be slightly different, and so you know it won't be a super smooth surface. And whether that's important or not depends on what you want it. If it's for a drawing of an overall shape, then that might be totally fine, and maybe you will just have to work on deleting some of the lines in when you create a line drawing, because it will, some tangent edge will show up there, or maybe it's quite important, and in that case you have to think about how you are defining the geometry, and maybe you draw something and have to kind of cut it back so that where on the edge where it doesn't work, it actually falls out of the shape that you want. And so you can see in this other example that I did a fillet between these two surfaces as well, did a bigger radius, and so now in this corner it's actually quite a mess. And so that's the price for actually having a kind of smoother transition between these surfaces here. But for me the question would be, why am I doing this in the first place like this? Like now I have five surfaces when I could have just one. And so maybe what I need to do is, now that I have this geometry, and maybe that's a good place to show the contour tool, maybe I actually take some curves from this geometry and then create a new surface from those. So yeah, let me take this guy and check. We'll move on to another layer. So the example I showed that student work, when I was saying that it works nicely, that the drawing actually has a kind of grid overlaid on it that defines the curvature. So that was probably created by the contour command. And so if I just type contour, and this is actually also really great for for a site model, for a topographic surface, you can literally create contour lines on an existing surface. And then maybe that's all you need for a drawing. You don't need the surface itself. You just export the contours. And so I just type contour, and so it's asking me the contour plane base point. And so that's just somewhere outside the surface. And then, so this is direction perpendicular to the contour plane. So I want the contours to go from left to right on my screen. So I'm drawing this way. And so once I click, oh, and then distance between contours. So again, I don't want it to be one because that will be a lot of lines. So I type 100. And so you can see these lines show up, and I'm just immediately gonna group these. So I can kind of grab them, and yeah, so I can just yeah, actually maybe just move this over so you can see more clearly. So now I have a series of lines that is, and this color again is quite light, that is defining this surface. And so maybe after having gone through this process, maybe what I can do is to select a few of these lines that I think best define what I'm doing, and then potentially use the network surface command, draw some curves in the perpendicular direction to be edge curves. Maybe I can aloft them, or I can sweep them, and that's going to end up with a smoother result. So even as you are working on your assignments, sometimes drawing something and then drawing something in 2D and then creating a 3D form and then creating another 2D curve from that and going back and creating a new 3D form might be the process you undertake to define and refine geometry. Yeah, so that's contour. And then one more handy tool which I mentioned during the reviews that could also be used to give a three-dimensional quality to a surface, depending on what you're projecting, is it's the project tool. So and I just want to show this in elevation as well. So so I have I'll just move this over so it's more clear to see. So I have this surface here, and then above it I have just a series of curves. And so I can take these curves, so I'm going to type project, and I can take these curves and oops, I don't want that. Oops. Once again. So select this curve and press enter, and then select this surface to project on. And so the nice thing is it actually sort of trims these lines by the surface, since outside it, there is nothing to project on. So again, I mentioned that this might be helpful for a 2D pattern that you want to overlay on a 3D object to maybe give an illusion of three-dimensionality of that pattern without drawing it. Or you actually you want a pretty regular grid to appear on a 3D object. So that can be a pretty useful tool as well. And so you can project any kind of curve. It doesn't need to be open curves. It can be any kind of line work. And they can be located anywhere in three dimension. Just be mindful that project works by projecting perpendicular to the construction plane, similarly to every other operation. Like that's what defines what Rhino is actually doing. So once again, in perspective view, our construction plane is the same as the plan view. And so I think one of you mentioned that you were changing your construction plane, which of course can be take up a diagonal form or a diagonal to its initial location. So you potentially want to do that. For me, I like to keep my construction plane the same and rather rotate my object so that I don't get lost at what is going on in the model. Okay, so yeah, so I hope that as you are trying this out, you are understanding what these tools do. So what I want to show here, and hopefully I'll be able to kind of go through all this, is I'm gonna hide this bunch of other stuff in the model for the time being. Is a more complex example of what you could do for the assignment. There we go. Okay, so yeah, and just turn this off for a moment. So what I have here is a network of curves that I have drawn that's kind of a rough design for this parasitic surface. So once again, two rectangles here that represent one bay in the Lacerre building, and I took them from two floors and sort of one with one gap in the middle, so I can create two projecting kind of enclosures that people can occupy on the inside, and then some sort of interpolation between those two rooms so that some sort of stair or slide or something can be installed. I'm not super worried right now about how physically realistic it is to climb up at that slope. Maybe it's like Google's headquarters when people slide down and so on from one floor to another. And so in terms of what I was thinking about when I was drawing it, so looking at this upper enclosure, and I'll just show you what the outcome here is. So I wanted to create something that on the inside it provides kind of ledge to sit on. So if you look at this curve just from the right side, yeah, so if you look at this cross section, I didn't measure this quite, so that's actually one thing that in your final drawings I recommend, if you have a section or even a perspective, to place some human figures that can be very sketchy or whichever type you prefer, but to give a dimension to what you're creating. But my idea was that people could be somehow climb up here and be sitting here on the inside, and on the other hand, I wanted this form not to just think about the inside, but to create these kind of dents on the outside where I would think that rainwater would be sitting, so maybe some birds come and like bathe in that little pool, or maybe we can put some soil and plant some plants, or that's going to happen by itself. In fact, the Lacerre building's fourth floor has this kind of layer of moss and so on. If you ever go to one of the faculty offices, you can see. I wanted to create this surface that performs at least these two different functions and kind of playing with the inside and the outside of it. And so, what I did is drew this network of curves, and I knew that I want to use the curve, the network curve command, so I paid attention that each of these curves, they are touching each other, and that's it's a bit tricky to see in this kind of 3D wireframe mode. Obviously, if they don't, then the tool isn't gonna do what I want, so I had to spend some time refining my curves, and in this case, I mentioned that for the most part, don't ever use the near snap when you're drawing the curve and just snapping anywhere on an object. But in this case, because I was pretty loose with this drawing, that's one way in which If I want to create a freeform curve, so I'm interpolating between points, and yeah, so you can see that what I'm able to do here is to make sure that the curve I'm drawing is actually it's going through these three other curves. And oh yeah, you can see that here I actually snap to some intersection that's just an intersection in the current view. So you have to be careful when you're drawing, especially when you're drawing in perspective view, it can be a big mess. Yeah, so it's just working with the different snaps, object snaps is gonna help. But so, yeah, basically, let's begin by looking at this piece here. And so once again, I'm just gonna make a new layer for a new set of surfaces. So yeah, what I want to do in this case is, yeah, let's just gonna group and hide these other surfaces for the time being so it's easier to see. So what I want to do is actually leave an opening here, so I already have my geometry set up for joining it to the other shape. And so I want to create a surface that wraps around this entire piece. So I'm going to use network surface for that. And so select all these lines. These are my vertical lines, and then these are my horizontal lines. And so yeah, so this is what is happening. And so you can see that what I mentioned about these two little pools, I only define those in the middle. So I was kind of thinking about how to allow that depression to not, basically the water to be able to collect in the middle there and then taper off or kind of taper up on the edges. Oh, and this is in the, let's just put this guy on the layer I want to work on. Yeah, so this is the surface here, and yeah, so I'm pretty happy with that one. And so let's bring up these other curves. And so the next thing I want to do is to continue down and create this connecting piece. Let me just remember, because I was kind of moving over between different examples, if this is the same. Yeah, so yeah, basically what I want to do is, in this case, take these two curves that define these two openings and create a surface that smoothly connects them. And so for this one, the easiest to do would be to do a sweep using these two rails. So I'm going to select these as cross-section curves, and so this is what's happening. And so you can see that some kind of edge is beginning to happen here, which makes me think that probably this kind of big sweep between the two geometries might be not exactly what I want in terms of the shape, and I probably would, while working on this shape, go back and try to create a smoother transition, potentially by inserting the third cross section there that kind of smoothens out this difference. Right now I'm just gonna leave it at that to just be able to show you this example, but I mean that's you know, when you're just drawing loose geometry and running these commands, you want it's easier to lose kind of control and end up with some unintentional geometry and complexity than when you're working with rectilinear geometry. That's for certain. And so, okay, so I have these two surfaces here, and so what I want to do is join them together. And yeah, so as I mentioned, what is happening is that they aren't. It's saying that it's unable to join them. And so again, it's difficult to actually really zoom in and see what is happening. I mean, I use the same curve for both operations, but for some reason there is no perfect alignment between them. And so one of the things I would do in this case initially, the first thing I would try is to actually and say, okay, I want to use this curve for sweeping, or this lower curve, I'm going to use the curve that I drew. But for the upper one, I want to use the actual edge of this surface, which I'm not 100% sure perfectly aligns with the initial curve, since I was using this network surface command, and so it might be slightly off. And so what I want to do is to actually create a new curve from the edge of the surface. So I'm getting messed up with layers here, but I'm just gonna make a new curve layer just to make sure that I'm not mixing up things. So this is gonna be blue. And so I already showed this command, but basically the duplicate edge is very helpful when you want to, you have a 3D geometry and you want to go back to curve. So it's asking me to select an edge to duplicate. And so, and yeah, let's put this on the correct layer. So now I have this blue curve that I can use to redo this sweep. And so let's see if that's gonna work. So I'm gonna select these two curves, and then once again, select the cross section. And so once again, I got this connecting piece, and let's see if now they want to join together. And so, and you might not even want to join, depending on what you are doing. It can be fine to keep surfaces separate. For sure, if this is to be 3D printed, like in Rhino 2 class, then if you are taking that in the next module, you will learn that you have to create a border type model. So it means it has to be fully closed, because otherwise a 3D printer is gonna get messed up. So if I wanted to print this, then I really gotta get to the bottom of what is going on and refine my geometry. So it's, well, I probably want smooth transitions too, but also I need to make sure that there are no leaks, because basically it's not, the printer isn't going to read my file. And so so now that even this didn't work, something is really not lining up. What I can try, and what I tried yesterday when I was playing around with this, is to actually use the blend surface tool and basically take these two surface edges. And what's kind of difficult here is that they are like pretty much in the same position, and so it's asking me to select the second edge. And what I'm going to do is just kind of mouse over this area, and so it looks like it's going to be blending these surfaces together. And if I hide these, yeah, I mean, this is really ridiculous, but you can see that as I'm clicking through these things, there is actually a poly surface here that was created. So I'm gonna undo hide, and so select these three objects, and now try join. And so there was a tiny gap between these surfaces, and I created a connecting piece with the blend tool, and so now I was able to join this into one surface. And in terms of the curvature at that edge, it's probably not the greatest thing what's happening there. There's some basically three surfaces at this infinitely small gap. So potentially what you end up with is that you may create a make 2D drawing and you're gonna have two curves kind of on top of each other. But that's one of the dangers. So so one thing that can be done in that case is try to fillet this edge so that there is a kind of smoother transition. So we can try that, fillet edge, since this is already a but actually the thing is there are two edges, so I'm not quite sure what the outcome of this is going to be, and I'm just gonna put a sort of smaller number here. And working. But actually, yeah, so it looks like some sort of crazy thing actually is happening, because the geometry, the way it curves around, is quite complex. So so this is really not the best thing that could be done. In fact, as I mentioned, what I would do is instead of blending this infinitely close gap together, I would actually take a few steps back and cut back on the connecting piece and then blend them so that a larger extrapolate a curve from it and then use that to create a new new surface. So yeah, I mean, this is, in a way, it's an extreme example, and you know, I don't really love this shape that I'm creating, especially this really quick drop and sharp edge. So it's definitely an extreme example of dealing with these issues. But I wanted to show that, I mean, you are by no means, you don't have to do something like this. You can work with something more simple. But I wanted to show it in terms of being able to troubleshoot. And so let's look at the bottom piece. And so I'm going to just hide this for the time being. And so my idea for the bottom was that, unlike the top, I have this kind of bench here. What I wanted to create is a series of nooks where maybe like an individual can sit and read. And so that was just a quick idea for defining this kind of flower petal geometry. And so I would like, similarly to the other piece, to use the network surface tool to create, to define a surface here. And again, I want to work with leaving this opening empty. And yes, and so I need to make sure that my curves are properly intersecting, which I think they are. And so I have already split these curves so that I have these pieces here that actually I won't need, so I can actually hide them. So this is in fact what I want to work with. And so I'm going to do network surface, but I need to be mindful of that these two curves they are basically, they have the same beginning and end points, and so if I wanted to, if I just mouse over all of these curves and try to do network surface, then it's telling me that it's unable to sort curve, because I have duplicates that logically don't fit into this way Rhino needs to define a network. So for that, it's actually better to think about this by going through them one by one. So these are all the vertical curves that I want to work with. So this would be the outer limit of my geometry. And then these are all the horizontal ones that I want to work with. And so what you need to check is that this network visibly has four corner points. And so there will be this, in this case, I have this not quite planar top piece that I'm not including in my network. And again, this is not, I wouldn't design it this way. I'm just sort of quickly came to this iteration. Okay, let's just deselect the ones I don't need. So I don't need, this guy. Yeah, so let's type network surface, and so now it's looking like it's doing what I want. So that is that. Oh, except I forgot this last piece. So I'll just undo that, because it's going to be more complicated to just have it done separately. So there. So that's what I want. And then before turning back on my other surfaces, I want to actually finish off this this top here. And so I have these three curves selected, and I just want to close that gap. And again, it's not really ideal, because it's sort of awkwardly not planar because of this piece at the end here. But I'm just going to create a surface by patching it, and then let's see if these two can be joined together. And yeah, so everything I did with this example, I was unable to join. If I was really interested in creating a fully closed surface, then I could probably use the blend tool again, or maybe once again try and see if I can extrapolate a curve from the top edge of this surface. Just like I showed before. And so let's. But I actually. Let's just see if I can step ahead here. Yeah, so just in the interest of time, to just jump to this example that's here and already joined. So I figured out, I first joined this top with the sides here, probably by blending. And what I want to show you is, in fact, I was encountering the same problem with joining the kind of connecting slide piece with the bottom piece together. And so if I explode this surface, what I did, and you can see in the on top of the curve model too, I basically decided to just trim down my connecting surface to give a little bit of space, and then use the blend tool. And in this case, I'm actually able to see what is going on. So, and these actually, so this is sort of the one piece that is sitting between these two parts. So if I did want to create I'm pretty far from making a water type object, because there's the back piece too, which I guess supposedly if I have everything joined all together, I could extrapolate a planar edge and then create a surface and join that together. Or if that doesn't work for some reason, then I would again use a cut plane to kind of make sure that the edges are all planar and then create a surface there. I would say again, this is a kind of extreme example of complexity, and also I was more thinking about the kind of problems I wanted to show, as opposed to really the kind of parasite that I wanted to design. But so depending on whether you want to just simulate form, or you actually want to output a 3D object, you have to be careful how you're using these tools. And then one more thing I did here, which is just again to say that I wouldn't think of the assignment as just like creating one sort of blob surface and then you're done. I would think about, similarly to that example, I think this first project is a really good example of, and this is, it's something similar I'm doing, of combining different geometries. So there is an overall surface, and then these apertures are added, and then there is also something, looks like there's something kind of an orthogonal geometry going on. I think the way it's sort of inserted here, like in this drawing, it looks a bit awkward what is happening with that corner, but again, it's not so much from a design point of view, but from a modeling point of view, I'm just interested how is it intersecting, and maybe the flat deck there just needs to be trimmed by the wall. It just looks strange in the drawing, but that's just probably because of the way the view is taken. And so, two points. So one is, so what I'm showing here is just, a simple aperture that I'm using, and then I'm using that geometry to trim a hole in my surface. So when you're sitting in here, you actually have some light for reading, for instance, or something. To kind of work through this exercise by creating a surface, but then also defining some way in which the body can occupy it. So maybe it is a kind of smooth look in the wall that where you sit, but maybe actually, maybe in some of these there's a plane that's inserted, and or there's a ledge that you can lean on, and maybe there is a more rectangular aperture added. So I don't know if you guys know. I think it's kind of a hideous project, but there is this. I think it's a residence at MIT by Frank Gehry, and it's by no means as complex in its curvature than what I'm showing, but basically you can see that there are these kind of crumpled or folded planes, but the way the windows are inserted, like I could say that they are probably custom made for this project, but they are still modular and kind of negotiate that geometry in a pretty clear way. So all of them are vertical. They are not trying to follow the curvature, especially in this piece. That's pretty clear. So, so you might want to take the opportunity to kind of work between those two geometries. And that's where, I mean, you know, I don't know if this is really a great thing that's happening. It's kind of, it looks kind of like a diagram of, wow, I created this in Rhino and then now it's built. And yeah, I mean, it doesn't look very elegant, or in terms of a construction, not very practical. But yeah, don't worry about being practical at the moment. So so that's one thing about adding other geometry. And then in the remaining time, I just want to go over again, now that you have, once you actually created a design, then for completing the assignment, it will be for the whole class to be able to look at the work and actually see what is happening. It's very important to then think about how to draw or represent this complex 3D geometry in two dimensions. And so, you will have to once again continue using and learning to use the different tools to create various types of drawings. So I guess I can't quite remember. I think in the assignment sheet, what I'm asking is basically use all these different drawing types, whichever you think is most appropriate, but I would say probably a combination of different drawings to represent your surface, the occupation of your space. So you might want to create some plan and section cuts that very clearly describe your geometry, and I would encourage you to create a series of them. So it's not a perfect example, but one of the student projects here. Yeah, so this one with the slide, that's this slide through the Lacerre stairwell. The student has created this. It's actually a series of, I think, possibly perspective. I would hope it's isometric drawings where he's cutting a series of sections through this tube. And definitely I would tidy up some of the lines. Like, there seem to be an excess amount of lines here that just come from how he has modeled the surface. So I don't know if maybe these different surfaces here aren't joined together in Rhino, or they are just showing a kind of a tangent edge. And I'm not even saying to get rid of that line, but maybe just have it at a lighter line weight, or instead have a series of contour lines over the entire surface so it's a more uniform. But that I can actually sort of see this as a continuous form. And then, yeah, I guess here it's not quite clear what is this plane, what is he cutting through, but what's nice is these thicker section lines that show how this shape actually changes as you go through. And so the various tools that I have shown, so the section tool, and then the make 2D tool, of course, to create a 2D drawing, as well as the clipping plane tool, will be ones that you want to be using. So let's see. So here in this model, I just made a couple of iterations from this joint surface. So these are all flat make 2D drawings, and I'm looking at them in the top viewport. So these white lines here are actually hidden lines from make 2D. But so in this case, what I did is I drew contour lines over my surface in two directions, and then created a make 2D drawing. And let me just, there's so many layers here, but It's a bit hard to see. Oh yeah, I think it's this one. Yeah, so you can see that this definitely gives a, and actually comparing between these two drawings here, let's just change this to something darker too. So this drawing, and this you will probably encounter this, especially if working with more complex surfaces, that this kind of mess of lines is what I ended up when I used the clipping plane to kind of cut into my model. So these holes, I'm looking into my top level bigger enclosure, and then I'm cutting into these individual kind of nooks here, and a little bit into this. This section is probably not taken where it should be, but without the contour lines, it's first of all very hard to read, and also there are some totally freestanding lines here that aren't continuous, and they are the result of these kind of curvatures that from that particular view that I was taking show up. And yeah, so most likely when you are creating 2D drawings of your surfaces, you will encounter the issue of having to clean up the drawing. And I also think that, I mean, I mentioned that the newest version of Rhino actually improved Make 2D, so I'm hoping that that actually includes this aspect too, to be able to represent more clearly, or in a cleaner way, curved surfaces. But also what's going on, I think, is that my edges aren't, like, there are some issues that I mentioned with the edges not being perfectly continuous. So it looks like there are line segments from two different layers here happening. So yeah, depending on how clean your geometry is, that will follow through into a Make 2D drawing. But yeah, just to go over that once again, how I would work with that is, so I want to use the clipping plane tool, and so yeah, let's say I want to do a kind of a plan cut, and so I drew this clipping plane, and let's look at it in elevation. So if I zoom closer in plan, you can see that as I'm moving this clipping plane up in the front view, basically my plan cut is changing. And so yeah, maybe I want to create a plan that's showing a cut through the top part and then seeing the bottom in elevation, and then maybe have one from here, where maybe have one in the middle when I'm actually inside the slide, and then have a third one when I'm occupying the bottom piece. And so I would create a Make 2D drawing of each of these views, and then sort of line them up, and that's able to describe the geometry in a serial and more accurate way. And then maybe that's combined with an isometric drawing of the entire intervention with Lasserre's facade in the background, and then maybe there's a third a perspective image. Just gonna delete this. So maybe there's a perspective where I, actually go kind of try to, position myself.